gonna get married anyway, then wait till you're married. How? Isn't it you're gonna be married? So wait. My channel. If you haven't subscribed yet, then make sure that you click the subscribe button below and join the revolution. So in today's video, we are going to be talking about some of the struggles that you face when you are celibate slash abstinence. Now, the only reason why I'm using the word celibate is because it's the word that everybody knows and uses more popularly. But actually, I think the more accurate or correct term is actually abstinence. If you haven't seen my video where I explain the difference between celibacy, abstinence, intercourse, outer course, then go check it out. It's pretty much the building blocks for this video, wherein it gives you definitions for words, which I'm not going to be defining in this video again. Anyway, as I was saying, I want to discuss some of the struggles that I have faced as a result of being celibate, and I also want to give some tips as well for survival. I'm trying not to make this video too long. I'm trying to be a better person, so let's go. One of the very obvious struggles of celibacy slash abstinence, I'm not gonna keep saying celibacy slash abstinence, I'm just gonna say celibacy. Is that ignorance? It's not ignorance. What's it called when you know better but don't do better? Stupidity? I don't know. Foolishness? I don't know. But anyway.
Bruh.
One of the most obvious struggles of celibacy is that it limits your dating pool. And to be quite frank about it, nobody wants to date you.
It's sad.
You know what dating while celibate is like? Let me paint the picture for you. Dating while celibate is actually sort of like riding a roller coaster. Now let me paint it out for you. Close your eyes and imagine it. So there you are, you meet this man or you meet this woman and they are amazing, they're beautiful or handsome, they're smart, your conversation is amazing, you guys get along really well, you vibe together, your spirit seems to know theirs, like everything is at fantastic. Now, you get to know each other, everything is going well. So the roller coaster is going up, up. This is the very start of the roller coaster. Up, 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 you're getting to know each other, love talking to them, falling asleep on FaceTime together, wanna call them every second of every day, wanna spend all the time with them, right? Now this takes you all the way to the top of the roller coaster. Then, when things are starting to get serious and, you know, you really want to get to know them on a more personal, intimate, perhaps relationship level, you tell them, oh, by the way, I'm celibate or abstinent for whatever reason. And that, my friend, is when all hell breaks loose and the roller coaster goes down. And y'all know, when the roller coaster goes down, it goes down really fast. It makes you feel like you're dying, makes you call out for your mama, goes down really fast. And pretty much things go downhill from there, and not only do they go downhill, but it's like you're trying not to fall, you don't want your wig to get stuck on a tree, you're calling for your mama, it's rough out here, man, does your seatbelt feel kind of loose? You go on a whole emotional roller coaster, and then you go right back to square one, and the roller coaster ends, and you are still single. As you guys know, the culture of the world we are living in right now, wherein pretty much everyone is having sex. And when I say that, I'm not saying that to cause judgment or blame onto anyone, because one thing we all need to understand is that sex or the lack thereof is a personal choice, and everyone's choice needs to be respected. Anyway, it limits your dating pool because people don't want to date someone who they cannot have sex with, because for many people, sex is a vital part of a relationship. And don't get me wrong, it is a vital part of a relationship. However, personally, I believe that that is something that man and wife should share. Hence, yes, it's an important part of a relationship. However, I do believe it can be saved for marriage, and thus you don't end up giving yourself to a bunch of people who you end up regret giving yourself to and then feel like taking your sex back. I must say that while it does limit your dating pool, I don't actually think that's a bad thing, because it filters out people who are not for you. Now, what do I mean by that? As a person who is celibate or abstinent for whatever reason, a limited dating pool is actually good, because that means the people who are going to date you are people who are literally just interested in you. People who want you as a person, who want more than just your body. And also, as we know, there are some weirdo guys who will literally put on a whole facade to impress a girl, to get her to have sex with him, and then once she has sex with him, he literally changes and he dips. We all know there are guys like that. There are guys who will be in a relationship strictly for sex. Every time you link up, it's sex. You have no relationship outside of sex. Sex is your relationship. Celibacy or abstinence prevents you from having a situation like that, and also protects you from guys who are only there for sex. Because if he's only there for sex and you're not giving sex, he's gonna leave.
Bye, Felicia.
And this is not a struggle, but I do also think that not having sex does prevent you from having the blindness that sex can bring. So for instance, sometimes people overlook things because the dick is bomb, or overlook things because she got that wop. I know that's right. So it prevents you from having a situation like that. You're able to think with clarity and you're not clouded by sex or the bond that sex creates. And let's not fool ourselves. Sex does create a bond, and soul ties are real. The next struggle is those who may want to date you may just want to change you. What do I mean by that? There are some weirdos who literally go virgin hunting and only want to have sex with virgins because they want to break their virginity for whatever weirdo reason.
That's weird.
Basically, there are some people who are going to try and date you only because they want to convince you otherwise, because they think that they're the ones, that they think that they have the charm, the charisma, the sexual persuasion to get you to go against what you believe in. And I don't think I need to say this because I'm pretty sure it's pretty clear, but it's wrong to do that. To date someone because you want to convince them to have sex with you and you have no serious intentions about them is wrong, and it's creepy, and you should leave other people's kids alone. If a person starts a relationship with you and the first thing they want to do is make you turn against something that you have held onto for a long time, that you hold dear to you, that is important to you and maybe your faith, maybe you and your family, then that is not the person that you want to be with. Trust me, you're not the one losing out on anything. The next struggle of being celibate is that sometimes people assume you're stupid or talk to you like you're stupid. What do I mean by that? Literally, sometimes people talk about sex and automatically exclude you from the conversation because they assume you know nothing about it. Or sometimes people treat you like, you know, when you haven't had sex, people sometimes want to treat you like you're lesser than them. You know, they want to be like, oh yeah, oh my innocent friend who doesn't know anything. I mean, literally, people who have no business undermining you or looking down on you will literally think they have the right to do that because you've not had sex. So yeah, sometimes people undermine you because you haven't had sex, exclude you from conversations, or assume you don't know anything. I mean, guys, let's talk about this thing. Just because somebody has not had sex does not mean they've not had sexual education. Now, don't get me wrong, experience is very different from education. Practical is different from theory, of course. However, if you are a sexually educated person, you are able to carry a conversation. And that's something I want to stress for those who are celibate or abstinent, is that just because you're having sex doesn't mean you must be uneducated. While you are staying away for sex for whatever reason and for however long you're doing it, make sure you are educated so that by the time you do have sex, you are not going in there blindly. You know, get to know what there is to know about sex, about STDs, because one day the day will come and you can't walk into there uneducated. Now, of course, there are some things you are going to learn as you go, but come on, guys, there are some basic things that really, I mean, come on, please don't embarrass yourself. I mean, come on, guys, please. The last struggle I want to mention is for those who have had sex before and you struggle with missing sex or missing that kind of intimacy. So you find that if you've had sex before and you start a new relationship or you continue a relationship without it, sometimes you feel like you're missing that intimacy, that closeness that sex provided you with. And outside of that emotional intimacy point, there's also just the horny point of it, where you literally just miss having an orgasm, if you even have an orgasm at all, but that's another conversation. But yeah, you literally just miss having an orgasm, or you miss coming, or you just miss the feeling of just that release. There are some people who used to use sex whenever they're stressed or going through something, they would rely on sex to let it out, which is not a good thing, and it's pretty much good for you to be celibate because it's not good for you to use sex as a crutch, because it's not a healthy crutch. So for the second half of this video, I want to discuss a few tips helpful for those who are on a celibacy / abstinence journey. The first one, which I think is really important, is do not dip your foot in the pool or the water. What do I mean by that? Honestly, this is a person-to-person thing, and you know, mind you, all of these tips and even the struggles I shared are a person-to-person thing and do not, will not, and cannot cover all people. But I would definitely recommend not getting your foot in the pool, meaning do not do outer course. Because if you want to do certain sexual acts and not go all the way, depending on your discipline, depending on your partner, depending on the day, it may lead you to sex. It may lead you to wanting more. And that's the thing is, sometimes you may be like, okay, we're not gonna have sex, but we'll do this. But sometimes doing this leads to that. That leads to this. This leads to that. And then you go forward and forward and forward and forward until you end up having sex. Now, this point is even more heavy for those who have had sex before. I mean, if you have not had sex before, then maybe even though things progress for you, you will not allow it to get to that point because full-on sex is foreign to you. However, if you have had sex before and you are like, okay, fine, we're not gonna have sex, but let's do this, 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 that. Man, come on. Come on. What's that saying where they're like you're dangling a fruit in front of a donkey or something? Okay, I don't think that's right because that makes the donkey move forward. But anyway, literally, like, it's in the words of my mom in the I'm pregnant prank, it's literally standing in the rain and expecting not to get wet. So I would recommend not dipping your foot in the pool, because also once you dip your foot in the pool, you'll leave it there and then you get accustomed to the cold and okay, this, I can manage this. Then you go deeper and deeper. Next thing your ankles are in, next thing your knees are in, next thing your lower body is in, next thing you are totally swimming. And along with this point of not dipping your foot in the pool, one thing I must say is that when you have never had sex before, right? You don't miss anything. As I said, those who've had sex before, you find yourself missing something that you are familiar with. You know how good it feels, you know how nice it is. But when you haven't done anything at all, you may, yes, you still get horny, but you don't know what it feels like to have your horniness relieved. You don't know what it feels like to have an orgasm. Especially if, and again, this is only if you have not done any outer course with or without someone. And so because you don't miss the feeling, it makes it easier for you to stay away. And that is a benefit you have. Really, if you are on a celibacy journey and you have never done anything at all, I would highly recommend not starting, because it is good for you not to know, because it is better for you not to familiarize yourself with the feeling of that sexual relief. The next tip I have is setting boundaries for yourself and setting boundaries for your partner. You know, honestly, this depends from person to person. I would not say that there's a strict boundary that everyone should follow, because people's disciplines differ, people's desires differ, people's boundaries and requirements for their celibacy actually differs. But I would say set boundaries for yourself. If you and your partner are on a celibacy journey and you know that, okay, making out always makes me want to take your clothes off, then don't make out. You know, some people cannot do laying in a bed together. Some people cannot do cuddling on a bed. Some people can't kiss. It all depends on you. Whatever it is, make sure that you set your boundaries so that you don't find yourself crossing it. And also, both of you must be accountable for this journey, because sometimes you may be feeling weak, but when your partner is on the same journey with you and he knows the boundaries, then he's able to hold you accountable, or you're able to hold him accountable. So set boundaries for yourselves in the relationship, but also your own personal boundaries. And a person to hold you accountable doesn't only have to be your romantic partner. It can literally be your other celibacy friends. It can be your church people. It can be your whoever it is that is there to hold you accountable and walk the journey with you. I think that actually helps a lot. Now, along with the whole thing of dating someone who's able to keep you strong, I must say, I would not recommend dating someone who is celibate for you. Celibacy is a very personal journey. It is a decision you have to make for yourself. Why? Because it's a very difficult one. Because sometimes it is only discipline and your own personal motivation for doing it that keeps you strong, because there are moments where Johnny looks a little bit too good and Sarah's looking a little extra thick today. Meaning sometimes it really gets rough and you need your own personal motivation that will keep you true to your promise. So the reason I say don't date someone who's celibate for you is because they don't have the same motivation that you have. And so if they find themselves overcome by these feelings, then you don't know if they really have the will and the motivation to actually refrain from having sex. And again, this differs from person to person, but I would definitely say you need your own reason for celibacy. And again, this is harder if you are maybe a virgin person dating a non-virgin person. Then it's going to be very difficult for that non-virgin person, especially when they get urges and they miss what they've already experienced. then it gets really tricky. Another thing is, again, you don't need a situation where this person is like, okay, but come on, like, let's just do this, or, you know, but we're gonna get married anyway. Shut up. Eh, if you're gonna get married anyway, then wait till you're married. How? Isn't it you're gonna be married? So wait. Come on now. Some people want to enjoy the fruits of marriage and no marriage. If you're gonna get married anyway and you want sex, propose now. Propose. Propose. Get married. Let's see how serious you are. Huh? You're serious enough to have sex, but not serious enough for a marriage? Come on now. To my next point of know the reason why you are doing it. You cannot do it because your mom said no, your dad said no, your church said no. You need to really have your own strong reason. Even if it's because your religion doesn't allow it, make sure you study the text. Make sure you read it for yourself. Engage with it for yourself. What I'm trying to say is make sure you have your own reason and understanding for doing it or not doing it. Make sure that you believe in that reason, because sometimes that reason will keep you out of messy situations or keep you from doing something. That reason, you have to know your reason. And along with knowing your reason, which takes us to the next point, is you have to be strong, guys. This thing takes strength. It takes discipline. It is not easy. People think you're silly for doing it, or it's the dumb choice. It's not the dumb choice, and it's not the easy choice. It is actually very difficult, especially the older you get, but definitely be strong. Be strong. Fight the good fight. Something that makes it difficult is sometimes I feel like I have to fight for my celibacy. I feel like people always try to get me to stop or change my mind. You know, I don't understand why my sex life, or my lack of a sex life, is any of your business. Like, people really want to fight you for making your own sexual decision. But if they want to fight you, be ready to fight. How are you gonna fight? By knowing your why and believing in it and staying true to it. The last point that I want to mention, which I think is very important, is that you do not need to be a virgin to be celibate or to be abstinent. Because there are some of you who had a promise to yourself to abstain from sex, and you effed up. You know, you had sex. You didn't mean to, or I mean, I guess you did mean to. Either way, you had sex when you didn't want to have sex, and you have missed your goal. But here's the good news, is that it's never too late to continue. Literally, even if you've had sex for a whole year, every single day, you can decide tomorrow or even today that I will not have sex until whatever period you decide for yourself, whether it's marriage, whether it's the next significant relationship. Again, that's your own personal opinion. Now, for myself, I'm speaking from a Christian point of view, of which, that being said, the marker or the goal is actually marriage, you know? So even if you've had sex before, it is not too late for you to stop and to hold yourself to a higher standard. Will it be easy? No. Is it possible? Yes. And if you are Christian watching this, I have good news for you. You can pray for the grace and for the strength to be true and to see it through to the end. And also, for those of you who did have sex and you are Christian, I want you to know that God does not hate you. God has not thrown you away. There's a verse that says that nothing can separate you from the love of God. God does not hate you because you've had sex. And also, God hates sin. He doesn't hate you. He hates sin. The point I'm trying to make is, for those of you who are living with this guilt and you're like, you know what, I might as well continue because God hates me. God doesn't hate you. Get it together. You can do this. Anyway, that's it for today, guys. I hope you liked this video. Don't forget to comment, like, share, and subscribe. And I will be back with more videos. Peace and love, guys.